reduce that, you almost take all tension of the end of the film out.
Yeah, because
there's no escalation
there's
point.
There's no ticking time bomb that's right. going on for a half hour. You put in 20 minutes left.
So they made a good choice by putting it where they put it.
Well, I mean, do you accept, is it possible that they are, if they had done this originally the way that they intended to, we would have gotten to know more about the society before it actually we get the confrontation with the apes and their ability to manipulate the apes with these visions of
the only thing is because the humans don't have anything other than their minds to defend themselves, the bomb becomes, even for its kind of screwy thinking, it becomes their only sense of defense. They're going to blow up the planet, and that's their sense of defense. If you introduce that early in the film, then what do they have? I mean, there's no... You have to have a... You know, you have to have the revelation when you bring out kryptonite that you're going to hurt Superman. You can't just... You have to show it at the first that you have it. You have to bring it at the end. If you show it in the middle of the film, it's kind of like, what? No.
Yeah.
Why are you doing this again?
You're just introducing a deus ex machina at that point.
Exactly.
So you guys may not have noticed
it's like
this
what they
before.
Do with the James Bond gadgets. You know, the first 20 minutes is over, and then they show you all the gadgets because he's going to need to use all those at some point. There's never one that he's gotten that he never has to use or something like that.
Right, and you might, at the very least, if we're going to talk about putting the bomb in the middle, you might have him pull out of his breast pocket one of the things, the pen, and we see him write with it, just to remind us he has it.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't make it that the reveal.
Yeah.
That's just, or the payoff.
Yeah.
So before we jump into music theory, it fades out from the city into somebody playing on the organ. We see the sheet music, and it's not typical sheet music.
Nope.
What we do see, if you can read right there, is it says Psalm of Mendez 2.
Yeah, I had that on here. That says Psalm of Mendez. I thought it said Mendoza, but I guess it says Mendez.
No, it's Mendez. I mean, the script actually says Psalm of Mendez 2.
Which I want to know, does that mean it's about the second Mendez, or is this the second psalm that this Mendez has written about himself? What does that mean?
I don't know, but you notice it's on some type of stone tablet, right?
It was really weird, and I didn't have time to blow that up and look at it. I was trying to figure out, and I looked online to see what they were trying to do with it. I couldn't find any notes.
I mean, they can weave clothing, but they're still using stone tablets for their music sheets.
I bring you the 15 commandments.
Don't ask for logic in this film, Richard. You're going to be sorely disappointed.
Yes.
Right.
So this is where I get to go on about music.
Talk us through why this music sounds so
weird. Okay. So first off, I want to give a shout out to Mr. Roseman. I've knocked him a couple times because of, you know, Mr. Goldsmith wrote such an iconic score. Even the AFI said this is one of the Planet of the Apes score was one of the best ever written. Mr. Roseman been very derivative. He used a little bit more tonality, a clashing tonality than the percussive nature that Goldsmith did. This minute alone has 2 points where I was like, holy shit, he's here. And that would
he's
be
back.
At the very first of it when we see the apes marching, and you will have heard it in the minute that I put in here, there's a very dun 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 dun. It has this drive, and I felt, and then with that shot that Richard brought up, I thought, oh, we've got an army. Then he comes back with what is the virtuoso moment of them all. So I was explaining in between the minutes here, the simplest thing in the world.
We had to cool Todd down by pouring some water on him.
Because I'm pumped about this.
Save it for the podcast.
I've studied film, I've studied music, and I actually probably know music even more because I've been doing it all my life. But and anybody out there, if you...
Music by the minute.
There you go. If I quote one of the intervals wrong, people can blow me up, but I'm pretty sure, and I only listened to it today. But what's very cool that he does in this is these people are worshiping, and they want to take Christian conventions. Christian conventions use hymns that are based on the Western scale, which is 8 notes. We've all heard of an octave. And when we hear the Amen chorus, Amen, it often is a 5-to-1. It's the fifth note down to the one. And I was saying to Sean, the 1-to-5 is like Star Wars. Da, da. It's very triumphant, and it also resolves easily. What he does in this moment is instead of resolving back to the tonic, which is the note, he'll go up a third. So it's a minor third at that. So that's why instead of it going ba da, it goes ba. Every one of them goes the wrong way. So why does he do that? Because he wants us to feel, without ever saying, that everything is askew with these people. And in a matter of simply taking a couple of hymns, every one of them resolves in the wrong direction. And he also uses the seventh. The seventh note in a scale always wants to go to the eighth. It does. When you go up that chromatic scale, it goes and it wants to go there. He doesn't allow us to have that. And it's just a brilliant piece of a composer knowing oh, I can take the most conventional thing that everybody that's going to watch this film has probably heard, and I can f*** with it.
There you go.
And he turns it on its head, and it is, to me, this is the most brilliant choice this film has had yet.
And to all of us who had to sit through lots of church services in our youth, you're just like, ugh.
Well,
driving a knife into my heart. Let's get this over with.
You heard it was wrong. When you knew immediately something is askew here, and it's just him understanding the Western ear wants to hear it resolved down to one, and I'm going to take it up a third. I'm going to do something that's wrong. Instead of resolving to one, I'm going to go to the seventh, which still feels like you've almost resolved, but it's hanging there.
A little bit off.
So Dane's note in the script for this moment is, the form of service is a frightening mutation of ancient Christian observance, beautifully sung to just recognizably traditional chants and melodies whose harmonies have been futurized.
Well, see, that's all he had to hear was futurized, and he took the simplest of ideas.
And frightening mutation.
Yeah. I mean, that's, again, this film has so much potential. And when I sat there, and I remembered that they did something like this, and I started listening around, I was like, wow, that is just, that's so simple and so smart that I wish this film had more of it.
Do you have chills now? You look like you're about to chill.
I was almost about to explode while I was watching it.
So we are 54 seconds into this minute, and we actually get our first glimpse at the society that is the Forbidden Zone. We've had the four members of the council, with Mendez being the lead. We've had the two guards. We've had what...
The kids playing Ring
I've described
Rosie.
As the kids playing Ring Around Rosie, but this is the first time we've actually seen the their church, populace.
Mm-hmm. Which I want to know...
That's a lot.
Was that... But is that their entire populace?
I mean, if it's their entire populace, it's still a couple hundred people. I mean, the way they show it, and they show the church pews, and they cheated, it looks like a couple hundred people. Not like 10. Or 50. It looks like a lot.
I would say under 100, but that's just me.
But are we saying that this is the entire congregation?
That's what I want to know. Is that the kids are somewhere, they're here. Is this everyone that we're seeing, or is the church bigger that we're not seeing?
Or is this just somehow the leadership congregation that leads all the wackos? Are they all telepathic?
What I found really interesting was Mendez is the one who's kind of in the center of all of this. We saw the organist. And then we kind of pull back to a wider shot of Mendez in his robe, kind of in the center of everything. We see the population in the pews beneath him. We see what appears to be four guards,
I think we'll talk about that in the next
minute. And the next minute, it wasn't clear to me who these were, but that's Brent and Nova sitting in garb related to being church, hanging out. She's got some long hair.
We'll talk about,
I thought that, too.
In the next minute, I think.
Okay, we'll touch on it there.
All right.
So, Mendez then kneels. He then utters his line, "The heavens declare the glory of the bomb, and the firmament of his handiwork." We get a tight on him saying this. He's got some great mascara on. Man, I want that mascara.
Good guy liner going
right,
on.
Right, yeah, exactly. And he concludes with, "His sound has gone out unto all the land." And it begins to kind of pan back on Mendez as this particular minute ends to kind of show what's happening around him.
So this film gives into a convention for science fiction that bothers me often. When we see something like a race of humans that have survived in a church that looks like a combination of brand new pews that they got off the truck with molten lava rock walls, yet their costumes are perfectly clean. They are neatly stitch so that they have all kinds of weird like pleats and one and what I understand why science fiction does that. You want things to look futuristic, and I think this is a problem that really exists more for films back then. Don't you find it odd that they have this ornate
perfect
clothing that they wear?
Maybe they're using their telepathic minds to make you think that.
I could buy them more if they were, you know, wearing religious robes that simply covered them. I don't know. I just found that the stitch... Every time I see this, and I remember this going back forever, I was like, where do they get the clothes from? And that kind of stuff bothers me in films like this. I guess I'm
wherever
the only one. Richard's looking at me like, oh, no.
Wherever you got the pristine doors. I mean, there's a level to which you have to disconnect some of the things that are happening, and I feel like that's this moment.
I don't feel like I can on the clothes. Just for me, it has always bothered me since I was a kid. I used to think they were cool, and then I started going... do they who have a seamstress yeah. and well, who gets the dirt out?
They use
their minds and make it think.
They have these clean, potentially aqueduct tunnels. They've got electricity because they can light the tunnels. They can, unless that's an illusion. There is these elements to this primitive society that is too elevated just to be primitive, that they haven't actually made themselves more advanced.
I think the reason they made the choice to put them in these pristine costumes is to differentiate them between the savage humans that we've seen before.
Yeah.
They wanted to go one ear into the other.
Yeah.
And it's just for me, these
are monsters, we're the future, and then there are those savage apes.
I think it's more shocking if you see someone that looks relatively similar to the savage, but has this mind power.
This is 1970. They should look like the Sears catalog. That's what we should be seeing them. They should look like that era's fashion.
Well, I think that is the telepathic Sears catalog on display we see right there.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm not going to push that one anymore. That is minute 74. Did I get it right this time?
Yes, you got it right.
Minute 74 on the books. Does anybody have anything you want to promote?
Mm-hmm.
You know where we are today?
Zeus Comics.
We are at Zeus Comics.
Hey!
Richard, tell us about Zeus.
It's a store in Dallas, Texas. You can shop as online at zeuscomics.com, and we sell comic books.
Once a month on Wednesday.
And this amazing book that just came out, Planet of the Apes, with Rod Serling's original script. Put to a kind of graphic image of what he envisioned without the modifications and changes that were made that we saw in the movie, where the ape society is actually more futuristic.
Like today.
The three of us are just modernized. Chomping at the bit to actually read that.
It comes out in 2 days.
It comes out. Champing at the bit.
It came out yesterday, sorry.
Well, by the time you're hearing this, it'll already be on your shelves. Yeah. And
correct.
You can find
we're
it.
We're so excited to read Serling's original script brought to life by a comic book artist.
I think once the three of us read it, and I think probably within the next week or so, we'll have done that.
Yeah.
We should do an in-between just talking about that.
Well, and that might be a reason to bring the writer of Ursus on, too. We could do like a minute specifically on the book, a minute specifically
Perfect.
On the comic, and bring the writer in to talk about Ursus.
I think that'd be great. And I see with your, what's the women's club that you do here?
Birds of Prose.
Birds of Prose. I mean, you get some of those writers, so it's not beyond reason that we couldn't reach out and try and get these people here, right?
True.
I love it. Let's make it happen.
All right.
Okay, so that's minute 74 in the books. We'll see you guys tomorrow. Everybody have a great evening.
Bye.
Good night, everybody.
Beneath the Minute of the Apes. Beneath the Minute of the Apes. Beneath the Minute of the Apes.